Hi everyone, and welcome to week 2 of Ombarus Does the Complete Roguelike Tutorial in Python with libdecode. If you're just joining us, this is part 2 and 3 of a whole series of development tutorial that I'm doing right now. So if you want to look at the previous one or in the next one, I'm going to link the playlist to all of them in the upper right corner. So last week we got our little at character moving on the screen, and so this week we're tackling part 2 and 3 of the tutorial series, which deals with generating the map for our character. Now don't worry, maybe you think, wow, the whole map already? That's gonna be so hard. But trust me, this first part is going to be about laying down the foundation of what we need to generate the map, and then in part 3 we're actually going to do the generation, and it's not that difficult once you break it down into small pieces. So if you remember last week, we basically coded everything inside our main loop. So the first thing we need to do this week is extract all the entity related stuff like their position, their character, the color, and put it into its separate class so that it can become the base for all our future entities, like the player, the enemies, the pickups, and so on. And for now, this class doesn't need to do anything complicated. We just take the hard-coded stuff in engine.py, mainly the position, the character, and the color, and then we take all of this and we put it into its separate entity class in Python. And once we have this, then we can replace all the hard-coded stuff in the engine.py with our little entity class instances. We can even instantiate a new entity for an NPC or something just to make sure that everything is working. So if you'll notice now, we added the player as an entity, but we also created an NPC, but it's not rendering on screen. And the reason for that is that it's now time to upgrade our rendering so that we can draw as much stuff as we want. And as we're having more and more stuff to draw and it's getting more and more complicated, once again, we're going to try to extract this from the engine.py and move it into its own separate renderFunctions.py. And in this renderFunctions.py, we're going to create a renderAll function that's going to take as a parameter a list of entities that we want to render, and then we're going to remove all the hard-coded stuff in engine.py and move it into our render function so that we can render as many entities as we want, and eventually also handle all sorts of different rendering stuff, like rendering the background color, changing the level data, and so on. Now, as I'm programming this, I'm often asking myself questions about the architecture. What does it imply? What does it mean to do it a certain way? For example, as I was coding the clearAll function, I was kind of starting to wonder if it's really efficient to clear each character one by one. And I started looking up the documentation for libdecode to see if there wasn't like a clearAll that I could use that would be faster. It seemed like there was a method, but it's very simple to replace the loop later with the method call, and for now I don't know what kind of side effect this could have, so I decided to just keep following the tutorial, but it's a good thing to keep in mind one day if I ever have some kind of performance issue or something. So now we have a kind of rendering pipeline, so we can start working on drawing the map. If you look, the tutorial is starting to add like global configuration data for the map. So we already had the screen width and the screen height, but now we have the map height and the map width. Personally, when I'm looking at this, I feel I should probably start putting all of these into some kind of configuration structure and just pass this to my main method so that later I can load it from maybe some configuration file or something. But once again, this should be trivial to add later, so let's just keep it original. There's also seemed to be a debate in general in the roguelike community about whether you should have separate entities for your map tile, like walls, floors, and stuff like that, and actual entities like, you know, player and enemies and stuff. The general agreed method is to have separate entities for your map and for your characters. So that's why now we're going to create a tile class that's going to be responsible for drawing stuff like walls and floors and so on. And for now, once again, we don't really need a very complicated class to start with. We just need a Boolean to tell us if it's blocking or not and the position of the tile. Once we add more complex stuff like doors, walls, line of sight, remembered areas, and, you know, stuff like that, well, we're going to have a lot more tiles, and that's why the tutorial is suggesting to put this in a separate folder so that we can have all our tile in a kind of package that's easy to manage. So before we start rendering our tiles, we have to consider where we're going to put the map generation. Since this can become very complex depending on what you're planning to do in your roguelike, it's probably a good idea to have a whole class dedicated to just generating the map. So we're going to create this game map file and we're going to put our map generation in it. And inside this file, what we're going to do is start by initializing a square array the size of our map with all walkable tiles, just to test that it's working and to improve our render function with this data. We're also going to hardcode a 3-wide wall just to test the logic of the collision detection and so on. To render the map, what we're going to do is play with the background color in libtcode. This way we can even draw the map behind the player, even though normally we wouldn't be able to display multiple characters on top of each other. If we're just changing the background color, then we can do it. And to decide the color, we're going to add yet again another configuration to our engine.py, where we set the color of the collidable tiles and the color of the floor. And then we're going to pass all of this new data to the render function so that it can iterate over our game map and render everything. Now, setting the background is pretty easy. We just iterate over every tile and we set the background color based on the data in game map. And if you notice, we set the flag background set. There's a few different flags, and what they do is basically decide how we're going to blend the background with the foreground character. You can do stuff like multiply the background color with the foreground color, or you can make it glow, or use it to subtract a color from the floor or something, so that, you know, you just have an outline dependent on the background color or something. But for now, we just need a basic color set, so that's what we're going to do. Now, if we run the game, we can see that we have the player and we have the little 3-tile wall, and we can move the player around on the floor. The only problem is that we haven't implemented any kind of logic to detect collision so the player can move over the wall. So the next step is just to go into the move function and add a little check for the collision. Actually, I was going to add it into the move function, but then I realized that the tutorial does it into the engine. That's because probably they don't want to have to pass the game map. And if we were doing it in the move function of the entity, we'd have to pass the game map. So it's checking it before calling the method on the entity. And that's it for part two. Now we have all the little bits and pieces to create wall and floors with actual collision. So let's go to part three and figure out how to put all of this together into some kind of dungeon. In part 3, we'll start with a little bit of cleanup. So first we'll remove the test walls we put in part 2, and we want to think in terms of room inside a dungeon, so we'll reverse the initialization so that by default, instead of everything being floor, we'll have everything being walls, and then we'll carve out rooms inside the walls. I don't know if that makes sense. Again, this might look complicated, but we'll just break it down into small chunks. The simplest room we can possibly make is just a plain rectangle. So let's just start with that. We'll make a rectangle class. And in this rectangle class, all we're going to do is pass it the upper left corner coordinate and then a width and a height. And because it's easier when we're generating the rectangle to store the upper left corner and the lower right corner, we'll convert the width and the height to calculate the lower right corner. This rectangle is going to be our base for defining a room. But it doesn't need to know anything about the actual map. That's what the game map is for. So we're going to add a new method in the game map called createRoom, and it's going to receive a rectangle as a parameter, and it's just going to iterate through every tile inside the rectangle and flip these to blocking false so that we create floors like this. Now we do have to consider what would happen if two rooms are right next to each other. We probably still want to have at least one wall between each room. So to do this, we're going to just start the room at x plus 1 and y plus 1. That's going to ensure that there's always at least a wall inside our room. So not only you have to break everything down into small tiny chunks, but also you should try to test every tiny chunks. So we're just going to create a new method that will initialize a single hard-coded room and use our new create room method and our new rectangle class to make sure that everything is working fine. And as you can see, it looks like everything is going well. Now, all that's missing is something to connect our two rooms together. So we're just going to add these two new methods to create horizontal and vertical tunnels. And the way this works is pretty simple. We're just going to pass it a beginning and an end and a constant width or height, depending if we want it horizontal or vertical. And we're going to, again, iterate over the tunnel and set the floor on each of those tiles. Before we do anything else, let's always make sure everything is working. So let's test our tunnel method, and yay, it looks like we have a tunnel that's working. Yay. So, okay, one last thing we're just going to do is add two little utility methods in rectangle.py to first find the center of the rectangle and also to test if two rectangles are overlapping each other. That's going to be useful when we start adding random room in our level to make sure that they don't overlap each other's. Okay, so now on to the actual generation. First, we're going to, again, add some more configuration, remove all the hard-coded stuff, and pass the configuration to the createMap method in game map. Now, let's just get this out of the way. There's many, many, many ways to generate map. There's even like doctoral studies about good map generation algorithm, but this is just a tutorial, so we're going to keep it as simple as we can. We're just going to create random rectangles up to a certain maximum, place them randomly on the map, and add them to the map only if they don't overlap each other. And then we're just going to connect each room to the one before it, so that we can have one continuous tunnel going from each room to each room. Now to connect any two rooms, you need one horizontal and one vertical tunnels. So we're going to randomly select between starting with the horizontal portion or the vertical portion. That's going to give it a little bit of a random feel. Not only that, but since two rooms can be from one corner of the screen to the other corner, and you can end up with a really long corridor, there's a high chance that each tunnels are going to cross multiple other tunnels and other rooms, so that's going to give it a really random looking and potentially multiple doors on each room, so it's in the end going to look like a pretty decent dungeon. Now, even though I'm following it story all, and even though I have some experience programming, you're always going to make typos and mistake. And for example, here at the end, when I tested, for some reason, I only have one single room. And I had a little bit of trouble figuring out why. In the end, it was because I didn't indent my four L's properly, but it took me a really long time to notice it, and I didn't know at first what could be wrong. But another big part of being a successful programmer is trying to figure out which part of the code could potentially be causing problems so that you can quickly pinpoint the issue. And in my case, because I tested every single part of the code before, I knew that all my room generating code was good, so the problem could only be in the loop for creating random rooms. So I started by putting some prints to see if the outer loop was working, and I slowly started digging deeper into the loop to see what was wrong. Finally, I put a print in my create room method, and I realized I was calling it only once, which led me to realize that I had an indentation issue, and I fixed it. Also, sometimes random typos when you program, that's happened. Finally, everything looks fine, the character is moving again like a champ inside its own dungeon. Just like last week, the very last step is adding everything into GitHub, committing all the new stuff, and incidentally, if you want to check the code, it's all public on my GitHub, so you can also dig in and look more at the final result. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to comment under this video or, you know, go check out the community on RoguelikeDev in Reddit. They're very friendly and they're going to be very helpful. And see you all in my next episode. Bye!